Hey guys, so I'm going to show you how to wirelessly upload firmware to your board. I'm using an SKR 1.4 turbo by Big Tree Tech. You might be using whatever. You'll need to upload your firmware, especially with an SKR, via getting the SD card that they give you, compiling your firmware, putting it on, and then putting it on the board and restarting the board the first time. You'll need to enable SD card support, I'm pretty sure, and then you'll need a Raspberry Pi running Octoprint for this to work. I mean, there are probably other ways to do it, but in my method, that's how it works. There's a reason why I do this, and that's because I don't always want to have to get out the SD card and mess around with it that way, and I don't want to have to plug out the USB cable from my Raspberry Pi, because I've got my printer in a kind of like an enclosure down here, and to get into there it's just a pain. So I want to do it by sitting on my sofa over here, and you know, not having to get off my ass to do so. So without further ado, let's kind of get into the how to do. Okay, step one of this is to get the IP address of your Raspberry Pi that's running Octoprint. And the easiest way for doing this is to actually like log into your router's control panel. Steps for this are different router to router. If you know how to do it already, you know, great. If you don't, then you kind of need to just Google your router, because I honestly can't, you know, explain for every different router how it works. Identify your Raspberry Pi on your list of connected devices. If it's given a strange name, then or if you can't see names on your router, then just unplug your Raspberry Pi. Give it a second, maybe make a screenshot, plug it back in, and then you'll see a new device, and that will be a Raspberry Pi. Take note of its IP address and its MAC address. You can copy its MAC address here, but just remember the last few digits of your IP address. Try and memorize the whole thing. Write it down or screenshot it if you need to. Then you will want to go into DHCP reservation. Again, this will be different router to router. Pop in your MAC address for your Raspberry Pi. Okay, there was a bit of a mess there, but you need to try and copy the MAC address. Type that in there. Your IP address that you want to give it, I'd recommend just using the IP address that was like automatically assigned to it by your router. So 192.168.107 is what I had. So like it would look like this. Doesn't like spaces. And then I'd hit apply. I've already got it done though, so I don't need to do that. This just means that when your router restarts, if it gets unplugged or if there's a power out or if it just restarts automatically, sometimes they do, then it will always have this IP address. Once you've got that, just remember this IP address here. I'll copy it for ease of kind of what we're gonna do next. On a Mac, you just need to type in, you just need to open up terminal. You can also do that by going into your applications and just look for a terminal. It is in utilities and it's down the bottom. Okay, but I just used a little keyboard shortcut. So open up terminal, type in SSH pi at your IP address. So you can just paste that now. It'll ask if you want to accept the host key, type in yes and hit enter. Enter in the password, which is Raspberry. Sorry, I typed there a few times wrong. Once you're in here, change the password of your Raspberry Pi, because Raspberry is pretty, it's pretty kind of dodgy. So type in sudo raspi-config. Again, type in Raspberry, go to system options, go to password, hit enter. Now you need to type in whatever you want it to be. Repeat, saved successfully, great, hit exit. Now the next thing we need to do is we need to sudo So this is just updating the apt-get. It just means that when it downloads things, it's downloading the newest packages. It's always a good thing to do. Some people recommend upgrade as well. I think it's a little bit overkill and it always takes way too long. Next thing we want to do is we want to go sudo, type in sudo install Netatalk. It's actually already installed and it doesn't need to update. It may just install a new version for you, or it may not already have it. It depends on the version of Octopi you're using. The next thing you need to do is you need to restart Netatalk. So we type in sudo systemctl restart Netatalk. Actually, sorry, no. Next thing we need to do is we need to update the conf file. So we need to go sudo nano etc netatalk afp.conf. And you need to make sure that it has homes baster regex equals dash or support slash home. There's a very good page here that actually explains how to set up Netatalk in different ways. You can set up different folders that it will automatically. You're essentially setting up a file server that you can connect to that's running on your Raspberry Pi that lets you copy and paste files to and from it, or change files and directories inside your Raspberry Pi using your Finder on Mac or your folders on Windows. And there's if it's not already got baster regex equals stash home, just copy it from here and paste it in. There's also lots of instructions about how to use Netatalk. So that's good though. I'm just gonna make a change here. Leave a comment because. So type control X and it'll ask if you want to save, type Y, hit enter. And now you need to hit enter to save it as that file name, Netatalk, afp.conf. Now we need to restart Netatalk, so we go sudo systemctl Netatalk. Sorry, systemctl restart Netatalk. That'll restart Netatalk. Next, we need to open up our Finder. We'll go to Go, and we'll connect to server. You see, I've done this before, but I'll just retype it for your kind of like how it works. AFP. Semicolon dash dash 192.168 in my case .0.107. It'll be different for you. It'll ask for a username and password. This is your Pi username and password, so I've got Pi and my password. Hit enter. Use Pi home. I don't think you'll see these options, you'll just have Pi home. Great, and now you can access the files and folders on your Raspberry Pi as if they were on your own laptop or your own computer. The next thing we need to do is compile our firmware. So open up Visual Studio Code. Click over here. You can hit Command O, and you need to find the directory that has your Marlin. You've downloaded Marlin, and I'm working on the assumption that you already know how to compile firmware. But make sure it's the one that's inside the file you zipped, unzipped, not the like the file you unzip, but the one inside it says Marlin, whatever version it's running. Click open. We'll click allow. Now, for the purpose of this, I'm going to update the. So we'll click in Marlin here, configuration.h. I actually am running Raspberry Pi. I'm running a printer that has a auto bed leveling, and I've got 5 points, Pro points at the moment. It's too many because it's an AM8 printer, and it's got a small bed. It doesn't need that many. It takes ages, so. I'm just going to find grid max. Great. Okay, you can see here I've got 5 Pro points. I just want it to be 3, so it'll do a 3x3 grid. I'll hit command save. Then we go down here to Platformio. Find the chip of the board you're running. Mine's SKR 1.4 Turbo. So it is running, it's always hard to find, LCP1769. Click build. Okay, that took a little bit longer than normal to actually do. It took a minute and a half. But it's built now, so we can actually close Visual Studio Code. And for the purpose of this, I'll just close down these. The purpose of this, we've got Finder here. Let's open up a new Finder window. And on the left, I'll go to my desktop where I keep my Marlin config. And I need to go inside of this, and I actually need to view the need to view the hidden folders. So I hit Command Shift and full stop, and that will reveal your hidden folders. You need to go to .pio, and then the next subdirectory is build, and you need to see your chipset here. That'll have its own folder. Open that up, and inside that you've got your firmware.bin file. Obviously, if you've built a firmware before, you'll know this. Then I'm going to open up a new folder here on the right. So remember, on the left is my actual laptop, kind of where things are stored. On the right, we have, let's go to our OctoPi. So we've connected to that with the AFP. Remember, you're going to go connect to server. And I'm storing mine in documents. So let's just open that up. You can see here the old one I compiled earlier on today. But here's the current one that I want to actually flash to my board. So I'll just drag that over and replace. Now we need to go back to our terminal. And what we're going to be doing is, I'll show you what it looks like to look at documents here. So ls just lists things. So if we look at the contents of the documents folder, it's firmware.bin, and we want to move that to /media USB. So firmware.cur, that's probably familiar enough to you if you've used an SKR board before. So to do this, we just type in cp documents, firmware.bin. And hit enter. And that's it. And now if we check the media folder, you can see it's got the firmware.current and the firmware.bin. And all we need to do is restart our SKR board, and then the .bin file will disappear and we'll have a new firmware.current. So the safest way to actually do that is to use Marlin's M997 command, G code command. So to do that, we go to octopi.local to open up our octopi. Do that. Connect to our board. Go into the terminal here and just type M997, hit enter. That restarts your board and it will flash new firmware. So now just to check, you can type ls/media/USB. Try again. Okay, it took a bit of time for the Raspberry Pi to reboot for it to connect to the board, but you can see that the firmware.bin has disappeared, which means that this firmware.current is our actual firmware that we've just built and flashed. So that's it. There's a few caveats. Just be careful because, I mean, I'm just doing this experimentally. I'd really love if someone a little bit more knowledge and experience with you know, the boards and how carefully you need to be with flashing them different ways, could maybe, you know, step in and make a better video with better safety. I've had a couple of situations where I've had two firmware.currents, or I've had the board not connecting to my Raspberry Pi anymore, and I've needed to take out the SD card and just copy over the firmware.bin and then, you know, power cycle the board just to get it to start working again. But that was in earlier, you know, methods, and this one seems to have been treating me pretty well. So there you go. I hope it's useful, and just happy printing, everyone. Goodbye.